Good morning and welcome to our online worship for Sunday, the 21st of March, the fifth Sunday in Lent. In a moment, I'll hand over to Dennis, who will guide you through the service this morning and will be preaching for us. But there are one or two quick notices I wanted to give you. The PCC met last night and we have come up with a plan on how we will return to the building for worship. At the moment, Holy Week will be online, with Bishop Brian Castle leading us through our meditations, singing us to the cross. And on Good Friday, we intend to have a short service for the last half an hour in the building, just to help us refocus for the end of Holy Week and to remind us of exactly what our Lord went through for us. So that will be on 2:30 at 2:30 on Good Friday. Those services in Holy Week will be via Zoom and the links will be available to you. On Sunday, Easter Sunday, we intend to be back in the building at 10 o'clock. We're going to start outside with the holy fire and then process socially distanced into the building and then have a service together for the first time this year. All of that will be streamed online as well. So there will be an opportunity to see it if you're not able to be with us in the building. It was with great sadness that we learnt of the death of Carol Tucker. Carol was involved in so many things at St Mary Magdalene's for a long time, and she will be dearly missed. Carol was involved in the toddler groups on Fridays, as well as with young families and various other women's groups. She was also, I think she managed to count money for all of the bits of the church's life, whether it be the bookshop or the coffee shop or all the donations that came through, either in the red box or on Sundays. So the church wardens wanted to express their great thanks because all of her records were absolutely immaculate and she will be dearly missed. She was quite a shy person, but actually, when it came down to it, she was always involved behind the scenes. Her funeral will be on the 6th of April at 11:30 at Taunton Crem. And obviously, with the situation that we find ourselves in at the moment, that will be by invitation only. But if you do get in touch with Whites and Sons, they will be able to provide you with the links to the live stream of that event if you would like to join in with it. Obviously, we'll be remembering Bill and the family in our prayers as he continues to prepare for that service after Easter.
Here we are again. Sunday by Sunday, we join together in online worship to our Lord. Welcome to you all, whether you're a regular or a visitor, whether you live in Taunton area or are far, far away. We unite this morning in the name of Jesus to worship the living God. We do so now with our first hymn, Lord of all Hopefulness. Do sing along.
Lord, O kindly
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. Together we say, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we are led in our gathering prayer and confession.
God, we may come to you dry, discouraged, feeling frail or powerless. But we come believing that you have the words of eternal life. Speak to our dry bones. May your word and your spirit give us life and empower us to speak truth into this world you love. Amen. Come to me, all who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let us then show our love for him by confessing our sins in penitence and faith. We are often slow to follow the example of Christ. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We often fail to be known as Christ's disciples. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We often fail to walk the way of the cross. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May the Father forgive us by the death of his Son, and strengthen us to live in the power of his Spirit all our days. Amen.
Having confessed our sins and received God's blessed forgiveness, we have the collect for today, the fifth Sunday in Lent. Gracious Father, you gave up your Son out of love for the world. Lead us to ponder the mysteries of his passion, that we may know eternal peace through the shedding of our Saviour's blood, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We now have our Gospel reading.
Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. I am the light of the world, says the Lord. Whoever follows me will have the light of life. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honour. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing there heard it and said it was thunder. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Sir, we would see Jesus. That's what a small group of Greeks asked Philip the disciple. What would we do if somebody came up to us and said we want to meet Jesus? They presumably have come to us because we and our Christian friends talk about Jesus, not just about God and the church. They may see that there's something special in us. Hopefully that's the case. That, for instance, there's a light in our eye, or perhaps it's that sense of caring for others. They may have seen us handle grief or pressure. They want to know how they too can meet or see Jesus. What would we do? What would we say? There's a great difference between Philip being asked that question and us being asked it. Philip had a flesh and blood person that he could take them to, but we don't. We cannot meet Jesus with our five senses. And yet, the Greeks didn't just want to meet the flesh and blood Jesus. They wanted to meet the Jesus who could make a difference. Jesus, the Saviour. Anyway, what would we do if somebody came to us wanting to meet or to see Jesus? Would we give them a tract? Five steps to becoming a Christian? Would we try to give a verbal answer, some sort of explanation? Would we invite them to a church service? Would we take them to the vicar? Or what would we do? Philip became known as Philip the Evangelist. He was a natural at leading people to Jesus. Remember how he went and told his friend Nathanael. He said to him, "We have seen the Lord." Nathanael's initial reaction was enough to knock the smile off Philip's face. He said, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" But Philip was undaunted by this rebuff, by this cynical response. He said, "Come and see." Nathanael did, and became one of the 12 apostles. His other name was Bartholomew. But what did Philip do on this occasion in today's Bible reading? When the Greeks came to him wanting to see Jesus, what did he do? Did he lead them off to Jesus? No, he did not. Instead, he went to Peter to get a second opinion. Peter was a leader and was the natural person to turn to when in doubt. The reason for this doubt is that Philip wasn't at all sure that Jesus and the gospel were for the Greeks at all. After all, they weren't Jews. They weren't what we would call churchgoers. They were outsiders. Ah, as far as Philip thought. We never actually hear what happened to those inquiring Greeks. I hope they got to see Jesus, because I'm sure he would have given them a warm reception. Actually, I'm not sure what help Peter would have been to Philip either. He himself had serious doubts about the gospel being for anyone who was not a Jew or an Israelite. In fact, for Peter, it took a rooftop vision of Jesus' death and resurrection after the Holy Spirit had been given, for Peter to learn the lesson that the gospel of Jesus was for everyone, not just for Jews only. You may remember that vision that Peter had on the rooftop in Joppa during his afternoon siesta. He saw a sheet let down from heaven containing all sorts of animals, clean and unclean. And God told him to eat. And from this lesson, Peter went straight off to visit an inquiring Roman centurion, Cornelius. Peter was absolutely amazed that as he told them the gospel of Jesus, the Holy Spirit fell on them. Yes, the gospel was for everyone. Just as Peter learned this lesson that Jesus is for anyone who wants to meet him, so also Philip learned the same lesson. Do you remember the encounter he had in the middle of a desert road? It's described in Acts chapter 8. An Ethiopian eunuch on this occasion, the treasurer of Queen Candace, is passing by in his chariot reading a passage from the prophet Isaiah. Philip hears this and gets into conversation about the passage. The Ethiopian doesn't understand it, and so Philip offers to explain. He is invited up into the chariot, and Philip tells how Jesus is the fulfillment of this prophecy. The Ethiopian believes and wants to be baptized immediately. And right there and then, Philip baptizes him. Another outsider becomes a believer and is added to the people of God. It's all very well for us to be horror-struck and to think how prejudiced Philip and Peter were, but believe you me, we're often just as bad ourselves. People who don't come from our backgrounds, who are rather messy, let's say, or who are super smart, or who are of a different colour, or who come from a different religion, or who are very intellectual, may be written off by us before they have a chance of meeting Jesus. So, returning to my initial question, if we or someone else were to say, we would see Jesus, what would we do or say? First, it is important to know what they are actually looking for. What sort of Jesus do they want? What are they expecting or hoping to see? A prophet or a priest or a king? Someone who will give them victory? Someone who will heal them? Of course, the Jesus that the Greeks would have found was flesh and blood, a Jew, dressed simply, humble and seated on an ass. If they had hung around long enough, they would also have seen him bloodied and hanging on a cross. But what would we or others expect to see in this day and age? This Sunday, today, marks the beginning of Passion Tide. That is, the start of Jesus' final journey on earth, as he heads towards his final rejection, his suffering and his crucifixion. But today, Jesus is also risen and glorified. He is now King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is magnificent. And yet, he is also still the same Jesus that walked this earth. The book of Revelation puts this contrast so well. Jesus is described as both the lion and a lamb. The lion and the lamb lie down in perfect harmony in the person of Jesus. Yes, Jesus is still humble and lowly, but he is also fearsome and glorious. We approach him with confidence as to a friend, the friend of sinners, but we also approach him on bended knee, filled with awe and reverence. This is the Jesus that we know, and this is the Jesus we want to introduce others to. How, you may ask? We can talk about him. We can lend a booklet. We can bring them to church or tell them to watch online. We can ask a fellow Christian if we need help to explain the truth. We can pray for them. But in every way, we are called to play our part in leading others to Christ Jesus. Sir, we would see Jesus. Amen. We will now join in saying what we believe, and that will be followed by a time of prayer.
We say together in faith, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We believe in God the Father, who created all things, for by his will they were created and have their being. We believe in God the Son, who was slain, for with his blood he purchased us for God, from every tribe and language, from every people and nation. We believe in God the Holy Spirit. The Spirit and the Bride say, Come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Let us pray in the knowledge of God's extravagant love. God of all, we turn to you to pray for those who, like Christ, are ridiculed for what they believe and persecuted for what they hold dear. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. God of all, we turn to you to pray for those who, like Christ, put their lives on the line for others, in the full knowledge of the risks they are taking. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord of all, we turn to you to pray for those who, like Christ, are beaten and abused, the victims of torture and brutality. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord of all, we turn to you to pray for those who, like Christ, are betrayed by friends and colleagues, who run away at the hour of their greatest need. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord of all, we turn to you to pray for those who, like Christ, know their need of you and turn to you in prayer. We remember those we know who are sick or suffering at this time, and those whose year's mind falls now, remembering particularly Judith Browner, Paula Lee, Mary Beer, Madge Stubbs, Norma Puncheon, Fenella Arundel, Ronald Dawson, Barbara Hoyt, and Janet Long. Be with all those who mourn and are sad. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We come now to that point in the service where we express our love and unity for one another in the words of the peace. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. So we prepare the table for our communion service. Bread and wine. God of our journey, as we walk with you on your path of obedience, sustain us on our way and lead us to your glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right and good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God and everlasting Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son. For in these 40 days you led us into the desert of repentance, that through a pilgrimage of prayer and discipline we may grow in grace and learn to be your people once again. Through fasting, prayer, and acts of service, you bring us back to your generous heart. Through study of your holy word, you open our eyes to your presence in the world and free our hands to welcome others into the radiant splendor of your love. As we prepare to celebrate the Easter feast with joyful hearts and minds, we bless you for your mercy and join with saints and angels forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them, and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice, made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with St. Mary Magdalene, St. John, and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Trusting in the compassion of God, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Amen. The blood of Christ keep you in eternal life. Amen. And so we pray, Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do also for you. Give us the will to be the servants of others, as you have thus been the servant of all, and gave up your life and died for us, that are alive and reign now and forever. Amen. Together we say, Holy Spirit, breathe through us, so that we might speak out words of light and life, where we see only shadows and death. Send us into this world of exile with the promise of a world renewed, and the power of our risen Saviour, in whose name we pray. Amen. We now sing along with a song by Stuart Townend and Keith Getty, Speak, O Lord, as we come to you.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see your majestic love and authority. Words of power that can never fail, let the truth prevail, override. Grasp the heights of your plans for us. Truths unchanged from the dawn of time that will echo down through eternity. And by grace we'll stand on your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory.
And now may God the Father, who does not despise the broken spirit, give you a contrite heart. Amen. May Christ, who bore our sins in his body on the tree, heal you by his wounds. Amen. May the Holy Spirit, who leads us into all truth, speak to you words of pardon and peace. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. And now we are dismissed.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.